We have previously seen the point mass filter as a numerical approximation of the optimal base filter. Today we are going to proceed with the particle filter as a substantial improvement over the point mass filter. The point mass filter was proposed in the early 70s and the particle filter was revealed in 1993. And that was a milestone in the development of nonlinear filters. So today we are going to see the basic principles of the simplest implementation of the particle filter and some numerical examples. So we have a nonlinear state space model in state space form and also as given by conditional densities. We have the optimal base filter with a time update and the measurement update. And the key idea in numerical approximations is to evaluate a given trajectory where the measurement update is just a multiplication with the likelihood function and the time update can be approximated with sums instead of the integral. So the basic idea is the same as in the point mass filter, so we assume that we have a representation of the predictive density in this case as the weighted sum of weights and Dirac distributions, that is very narrow distributions centered around grid point xk of I. And for this we can compute the mean and covariance and also the map estimate that is given by the largest weight in this approximation here. The measurement update is also the same as in the point mass filter. So we have the weight from the time update, we multiply by the likelihood for this particular grid point xk of I. We can compute this normalization factor by summing up all these products, which means that the weights in this sum will sum up to 1. So we have a proper density function after the measurement update. So now we come to the road intersection where the point mass filter differs from the particle filter. So the key idea is to sample trajectories, not states, as in the point mass filter. So we assume that each I here corresponds to the complete trajectory from time 1 to current time. And using Bayes' rule, we can compute this predictive density for the trajectory in a factorized form where we use the measurement updated weight, which we assume in this recursive fashion that we have given from before, and we multiply by the likelihood for the new state at time k plus 1 given the previous states. And this is the key trick in the particle filter to randomly sampling the new point here and modify the weight according to which point we happen to sample here. And this sampling takes place down here, so we have a model for the state transition. That means that we have a well-defined probability density function for xk plus 1 given xk of I, from which we can sample a new point here and add to the trajectory we already have. So that means that we update the trajectory in the same way recursively with a new point at each time. And the key idea is if you compare to the time update in the point mass filter, we had a sum here that leads to quadratic complexity. But there is no sum here, that means that we can stick with almost linear complexity in the filter. So there are a lot of abstract forms here, but if you go to the algorithm, it becomes quite concrete, and even more concrete when we look at the MATLAB code later. But let's see what the algorithm says here. So we initialize n particles from a prior distribution, then we iterate a measurement update consisting of taking the initial weight, which is probably 1 over n, with the likelihood for this particular measurement given each randomly sampled lead point. When we have done that, we need to normalize, so the weights sum to 1. We can pick out the minimum mean square estimate after the measurement update by summing up the weighted sum of particles. Then we come to an intrinsic part of the particle filter. You have to resample at this step to avoid something called depletion. And basically, if you compare the statistics, you take all your particles, you put them in an urn, and then you pick up one at a time from the urn, look at them, and replace them in the urn again. So it's random sampling with replacement. So after this step, we have a set of new trajectories. Many of them might be the same because we have this sampling with replacement. So the likely ones get many copies, while unlikely ones might get killed away. We don't keep them anymore. And after resampling, we let all the weights be the same, 1 over n. So this step is a bit intrinsic. You have to read it in book to get the motivation. I just can mention here that this needs to be done, perhaps not every time, but regularly to avoid depletion. And depletion means that one trajectory will get all the weight. So W here will be 1, while all other ones will be numerically very close to 0. So when we have done that, we come to the time update, which is very simple actually. You just take realization of the process noise from its distribution, and you plug that into the motion model, the state space model for X, together with the corresponding particle you have. And then you get the new particle at time k plus 1. So there are 5 steps here, and the MATLAB implementation also contains more or less these 5 steps. So if you start with a nonlinear state space model and the signal model, we will get the signal model out with the state estimate and also the measurement prediction. So we initialize the particles according to the initial distribution. In this case, we start with the time update. It doesn't matter if we start with time update or measurement update. So we take random samples from the process noise distribution. We plug them into the state space model to get the new particles, XP. We have the measurement update. We first compute the predicted measurement for each particle. That is done by plugging in the particles in the sensor model. Then we evaluate the probability density function for each prediction error. We compare the measured value to the predicted one for each particle and get the new weights out here. Here we pick out the estimate as the weighted sum of the particles. And here's the critical resampling step where we put all the samples and their weights in an urn and pick out new samples and normalized weights. And then we might save each particle here to visualize them afterwards. So let's look at an example. Hopefully this makes it even more clear what it does. So it's a simplified application of terrain navigation. So in terrain navigation, we assume that we have a map over the terrain. Here's an example where we are between 20 and 40 meters above sea level on this part of the one-dimensional world we are working on in this case. We are flying over on with a platform, measuring a distance to the ground. So we know our own altitude, we can measure distance to ground, and that means that we can compare the measured altitude of the terrain with the map. So this is actually our sensor model, h of x, that gives the altitude as a function of position. And we measure the terrain altitude at our own position. So we randomly distribute our points to start with, and after the first measurement update, we are at this level of terrain altitude, so we can be either here, we can be here, or here, or here. So there are many possibilities where we can be on this map given just one measurement of terrain altitude. These are the weights after the measurement update. Then comes the resampling. You see that all these particles with a small weight are removed here. And we get many copies where we have a high weight. And actually we have many copies of many of the particles here that is not visible in this kind of plot. Then we come to a time update, so we assume that we can measure our speed, but with some uncertainty. So we move our platform according to the speed. And that means that we also move all particles, like this one is moved a few meters to the right. And also some small process noise is added to this value. So that is what happens in one iteration, and if we proceed here, when we get the next measurement, we see that, okay, it looks like we are moving downhill on the map. And that means that we can remove all parts of the map where it indicates that we move uphill. So now we have essentially two big clouds of particles, so two possible modes of the probability density function. After the resampling, we see that there are only two clouds of particles left here. And if we look at the end, when we have traversed the whole trajectory here, we see that there is only one cloud left, and we are quite certain that we are somewhere here on the map. So that is how it works in a simple one-dimensional example. The world is not one-dimensional, but in this case it's fortunately just two-dimensional, so we can repeat the same experiment in a two-dimensional simulation. So what you see here is a simulated two-dimensional world where we have water and islands. And on the islands you have hills. And we assume that we are starting here, that's the ground truth. We get the measurement that we are at sea level. Sea level is not so informative, so we can be anywhere on the map where there is sea. We have a prior, so we know approximately where we are. So after the measurement update, we are left with these particles here that correspond to sea level. So as usual, there is a link here to YouTube, so you can watch this animation yourselves. It looks very similar to the previous example. So I will proceed with the standard example of a radar that measures range with good resolution and bearing with poor resolution. When we looked at this example with the point mass filter, we had a uniform grid over this area here. Now we have a random grid instead. But still, this is ground truth. This is our estimate, which is the center of gravity of all points. And let's proceed with the first measurement. And we can see that the bigger circle, the higher weight this particle has. So on the border of this banana, you have very thin, small points and much bigger ones in the interior of the banana. So similar to point mass filter, the estimate is close to the measurement because we have small measurement noise compared to the state noise. In the time update, we spread out the particles according to the state noise, which, as I said, is quite large, so the particles get quite a big additive random noise on them. Now we get a new measurement, and we get a new banana approximation of the radar measurement that also weighs in, of course, the prior we have from the previous measurement. And we proceed with time update, measurement update, time update, measurement update, time update, measurement update, and now a final measurement update. And we can compare this trajectory to the point mass filter. They look very similar in this case. So the result of the point mass filter and particle filter are quite similar for this case, but there are many important differences. One you notice immediately by the representation of the state space. The random cloud of particles here look quite different from the uniform grid we had in the point mass filter. So to sum up, the basic SIR particle filter is quite simple to write down and implement. It includes a few steps. First, you have to decide how many particles you have. That's the only design parameter so far we have seen. You generate initial states from the prior randomly. And then you come to the recursion. If you start the measurement update, you take the weights you have initially and multiply by the likelihood. You normalize the weights. You output the state estimate as the weighted mean. The resampling step is needed to avoid depletion. And here you put all particles with their associated weights in an urn and sample with replacement. And after that, you normalize the weights to 1 over n. And in the time update, you generate random samples from the state noise, and you plug in the state noise in the state space model with the corresponding particle, and you get a new particle for the next time. And then you can repeat the recursion from the beginning. The main advantage of the particle filter is that it's easy to implement. It includes an adaptive random grid. It has almost linear complexity, and it explores the state space much more efficiently compared to the point mass filter. So at least for state spaces with 3 or 4 states, it works quite well. So reading advice is section 9.3.